In this episode of Mind Pump, you know, we wanted to tackle something that's probably hurting a lot of people right now, and that's fear and anxiety. Weird times right now, right? We're all dealing with this COVID-19 situation. A lot of businesses have had to shut down. We're all self-isolating. Uncertain, scary times. And, you know, we were thinking about, gosh, you know, they're going to tell us all to go back to work pretty soon. And we're going to have to not just deal with the, you know, being precautious and making sure we don't catch or spread this virus, but also have to deal with the fear and anxiety of being out in the world. And so in this episode, we talk about our own personal experiences with fear and anxiety, how chronic fear drove our behaviors in incorrect ways and ways that were detrimental. We talk about what fear does to the body, why it's essential, but also why chronic fear can actually be a huge health problem, how it affects your digestive system, your brain, your thoughts, and how chronic fear can cause a lot of problems. And then we give you actionable constructive options, things that you can do for yourself to not just manage fear, but to bring it to healthy level so that it's rational and no longer irrational. Now, this episode is brought to you by Legion. Legion makes some of the best muscle building, fat burning, and health supplements around. My favorite product from Legion is Recharge. Recharge is a creatine product that also has carnitine L-tartrate in it, helps with recovery. Of course, creatine, the most studied muscle building, fat burning supplement ever. It does help build muscle. It actually improves health. Anyway, it's my favorite product from Legion, but they have protein powders. They have a pre-workout supplement. If you like the caffeine pre-workout type supplements, if you like the tingly feeling you get from beta-alanine, try out Pulse. It's a great pre-workout. And right now, one thing that we really like is that Legion is donating a portion of their profits to the Center for Disease Philanthropy. And they're going to do this until things get back to normal. This is a charity that's helping support healthcare workers and individuals who are affected by COVID-19. So great company, great products. And because you listen to Mind Pump, you get a discount. This is how you get that discount. Go to buylegion.com. That's BUYLEGION.com/mindpump. Use the code mindpump at checkout for 20% off all their products. Or if you're a current Legion consumer, you'll get double rewards points. Also, this month, all month long, our two correctional exercise programs that require no equipment at all, just your body, so you can do these at home. MAPS Prime, MAPS Prime Pro, 50% off. So they're both half off right now. Now, MAPS Prime takes you through a full body assessment. It's individualized for your body, helps you determine what you need to do before you work out, how you prime your body so that you can get into deeper, more connected squats and deadlifts and overhead presses. Basically, you can make your workout much more effective with a good, solid, individualized 10 to 15 minute priming session. That's what MAPS Prime does. Now, MAPS Prime Pro is all about correctional exercise. You pick areas of your body that you want to focus on that have pain, mobility issues. You go in the program, you follow the outline, and you focus on those areas, and you dramatically improve your mobility. Again, they're both 50% off. Here's how you get the discount. Go to mapsfitnessproducts.com and use the code PRIME50. That's PRIME50, no space, for the discount. You know what's crazy? I was thinking about this a lot, you know, the other day, because we are getting to the point where we're going to have to, we're in between a rock and a hard place. Like, the rock is, there's a virus that's out there that's, you know, it can be dangerous for some people. We don't want it to spread really fast. Not going out there, not going to work, not being around people prevents the spread of it. This is a fact, right? That, you know, social distancing works in that sense. But here's the other fact. We can't social distance ourselves for that much longer. Definitely not forever, but definitely not, probably not for that much longer. We've seen record numbers of unemployment. We need people to make products. We need people to provide services. We need the sense of purpose of going out there. And it made me think to myself of like an analogy of like you're in a cave with your family and you need food. You're hungry. Your kids are hungry. You haven't eaten in days. And you look out in the cave and you see lions every once in a while roaming around. And you know if you go out there, there's going to be a risk of getting killed. But if you don't, you know you're going to starve.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like we're reaching that point because, people think, when they think economics, they think, you know, oh, some people will lose some money, not a big deal. It could be a very big deal. And we're reaching that point. And I started to think about it and I started to get scared. And I started to think, God, what is it going to be like when, because we are going to get the order pretty soon. States are going to start saying to people, go out there. We got to get back to work. We got to get back to our regular lives. But now we've been so scared with all this information, and I thought, how is that going to affect people's behaviors, how it's affecting our health? Like, mm-hmm. fear itself is something that we also need to pay attention to. You know what I'm saying?
Well, it's also, this is a very touchy subject, right? Because, I went down the rabbit hole of reading your conversation back and forth on Lane's page, and, you know, boy, you got all kinds of hate over it because people misinterpret what you're saying right now to, you know, you're pushing the agenda of, oh, we shouldn't social distance and let's just get everybody out there and this is all a bullshit, or like, I think this is a conspiracy.
No. I want to be clear. I'm not an expert. I'm not an infectious disease expert. I don't know when the right time is to go out into the world and go back to regular life or closer to regular life. I'm saying when the experts tell us to do that.
Right.
Well, and I'm saying that they're probably going to say it.
It's inevitable.
Soon.
It's going to come.
Yes.
And so it's like, how do we mentally prepare to then reemerge, you know, out of this? As I look at it as more of like a storm, like we're all kind of weathering this together. But now, you know, and there may be more storms that come, but like we have to live our lives. And what does that look like now?
Well, I think you gave a great analogy. And I guess the question is this is, you know, are we starving yet? You know, or are we borderline going to die of not eating? And of course the analogy for the lion. We're not all going to, that's not going to happen for us here in modern times, but you know, we can starve our economy at one point, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, at one point, if we shut everything down, let's say for a year straight, I mean, it would have this catastrophic, everlasting, response from that. If mm-hmm. that were to happen, right? And now we're not going to be shut down for a year, but then where's the place at? Is it 2 months? Is it 3 months? Is it 9 months? Or is it soon? Like, where is it that, you know, okay, we have to eat. We have to keep this thing moving. And at what point does the staying in become more risky than going out and taking your chances with the lions?
There's a lot of people that are waiting and going to rely on and need this check from the government that could be $1,200, $2,400, whatever. They need it because they're not going to be able to make it without it. That's one check. That's over – how long has the country been effectively, you know, shut down now? 4 weeks, 5 weeks, whatever? Mm-hmm. So we're going to get another one? My point is they're going to tell us we need to go out into the world. The virus is still out there. It's still going to be out there. It's not going to disappear. It's still going to be out there. So what I'm thinking, what I'm saying, and look, I think we should be precautious and we should be safe. But what I'm saying is that we need to consider the impact of our fear. Because fear, although it's a valuable feeling, we need it. It can also drive irrational behaviors and it can distort. It could distort your perception of things. You know, when people go swim in the ocean, you ask them what they're afraid of, more people will tell you they're afraid of getting eaten by a shark
mm-hmm.
than they are of drowning. The odds of drowning are so much higher. You know, when we drive in our cars every single day, we run especially when you consider it over your whole lifetime, it's not an insignificant risk of getting in a car accident. But we get in our car, and I'm not afraid every time I get in my car. I just get in my car, and I go.
Isn't that interesting? You know what it is, though, yeah. right? It's the two examples that you're giving right now. One of them is in our control. The other one is not, right? If I go
feels that way, right?
Right. If I go swimming, you know, I drown, it's by my own cause. If I get attacked by a shark, I didn't
something
see coming,
else.
Something else, an mm-hmm. outside force. And that's what we're facing right now is this outside force, an infectious disease that we don't have a vaccine for. And the what if becomes scarier potentially than the actual likelihood of it actually killing you.
Totally.
And that's
totally
what we're seeing.
And
right
this
now
is a big thing, you know, in something like 20%, this is a big chunk, right? 20% of Americans have like diagnosed chronic anxiety type issues. It's growing. This is before, by the way, all this went down. So this is before I would have to guess, again, I'm not a health expert on this, but I would have to guess that number's higher now, right? I would have to guess that there's probably more people right now suffering from chronic fear, mm-hmm, or anxiety than before. But so before all this went down, 20% of people had, you know, diagnosable anxiety type issues, and that drives a lot of your behaviors. You know, it drives the way that your brain perceives and remembers and thinks of things. I mean, it's funny because recently, I did an antibody test for COVID, and I was sure that I would come out positive. Actually, came back negative. Right, got the test back. I don't have antibodies, and for a short period of time, I felt more fear again. All of a sudden, I felt vulnerable. Like, oh, I'm gonna go out there. Maybe I can get it. But when I was thinking I had it before, I all of a sudden was my fear. Now I didn't change my behaviors either way, in the sense that I'm still washing my hands or whatever. But I know that fear can be a very powerful motivator, and it can have some really negative detrimental effects on your health. So we need to think about how to handle that as we start to move forward.
Well, you have to recognize too that that percentage that you just brought up about anxiety and fear in people, I wish I remember the statistic on this, but I know it was north of 50% of those people have multiple types of fear. So it's almost like a characteristic that a person has. So once you accept that you are fearful of things, you're more likely to be fearful of other things.
Totally.
Too.
It's a state of mind.
Right. Mm-hmm. And that is just a trickling effect. You know, the number one reason why businesses or anything for this matter, even fitness goals, fail is just the failure to start and begin.
Because fear of failure.
Yeah, fear of failure. And it's also the number one thing that feeds procrastination. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm afraid that I'm not going to be good at it. I'm afraid it's not going
to
be
good. You want to hold on to it. You want to launch it. It's your comfort zone. Yeah, the minute that you decide to put it out there, you're going to get judged. It's going to take on its form of like either it's going to win or it's going to fail. And that is something that's very scary for a lot of people to get going. And that's something that'll hold you back almost indefinitely unless you address it.
Dude, I'll give you an example. Like years ago, my house got robbed, right? I was at work and I get a call from, you know, at the time my wife and, you know, that somebody, you know, broke in the house and ransacked. So I jam over there and someone broke in, you know, took a bunch of stuff, went through all the drawers and, you know, there was a big mess or whatever. Obviously nobody was home. Nobody got hurt. And this happens sometimes to people, but you know, I have a family, I have children. I remember them going, they went through my kids' rooms. They stole my kids' piggy bank. Mm. The thought of some other person in my kids' room going through their
so
stuff.
So violating.
Yes. They went through my wife's underwear drawer, you know, the thought of some person doing that or whatever. And being the father, having the fear of what if I'm at work or what if I'm on a business trip and something happens. And that fear drove me to make some pretty silly, looking back, silly decisions. I bought a crossbow. I bought a sword. I had a sword next to my bed.
What is
samurai sword? Right?
Why a crossbow?
Yeah. Because
let me hear the logic behind that.
You want to know why?
You're watching Walking Dead.
No. I want to hear the logic on a crossbow. I've been robbed or cars. Two of my cars have been stolen. I think shotgun. So right. Why a crossbow?
That's because you have to wait. Because I got the gun. I went to go get the gun. You got to wait 10 days. Yeah. I'm getting the crossbow today.
But there's an example. What a great example. You were so fearful at the moment that this could happen again that I can't wait 10 days for the shotgun. No. I needed a crossbow
tonight.
For tomorrow
I got a
in case they come back tomorrow.
I got this freaking black blade, weird sword-looking thing that I could get. It's the fastest thing I could to my house. Put it next to my bed just in case I couldn't get to something fast enough that I'd go through hacking with it. I mean, just... Yeah. And every noise I heard for a month afterwards, I was on hyper alert. And everybody that walked in our neighborhood that I didn't recognize, you know, I'm gonna watch you. You know what I mean?
Right.
But it drove me. This fear drove me. And if I had let it, it could have, you know. Now, luckily, I was okay. Everything was fine. But I could see, like, I experienced what that did and how that drove my behaviors and things. And a lot of those were irrational because. you know, the odds of something bad happening again were still low. You know, you could do the rational stuff, get an alarm system and all that stuff, but boy, did it drive me.
Well, and that's an acute situation too. I wonder how much of that is like, how much that overall situation then has this compounding effect of built anxiety inside of you, and that just feeds into everything else that you feel anxious or nervous or fearful of too.
Well, you see that too when people will have like a woman who was assaulted by a man, and then now she's fearful of men. You know, that's like a that can cause that, right? Where now I'm afraid of men because one time I was assaulted by a person, by a man. Or you get in a car accident, and then after that, now I can't drive the car anymore because it's fear run amok. And the situation that we're in now, we have this invisible, you know, virus, this invisible pathogen, and you know, you go out into the real world. It's time to go back to work. You know, take the precautions. But if you let that fear seep into you and control you, it's never going to be, you know, back to normal like it was before. It's consuming you.
Yeah, all your interactions with other people, I mean, is going to be affected by that rooted fear there, where, you know, even just meeting people, acknowledging, greeting people, like all this stuff is going to change if it's all based off of, you know, like your sense of fear that you still carry with you, you know, versus like giving somebody the benefit of the doubt and really trying to immerse yourself again, you know, with other people.
I remember the story you told when you were a kid speaking in front of the classroom.
Yeah. Yeah, that affected. And that's the thing. I could trace back all the way back to fourth grade. Like it was yesterday, because it was such an impactful moment for me where I wasn't prepared and I was in front of my peers and I was trying to speak on a subject I didn't really know anything about. And all the insecurities, everything else started to flood in immediately. And I didn't know if I could like get out. I felt like almost a claustrophobia in front of everybody, to where I just stopped mid sentence. I froze, and then I walked off. And then later on, everybody tried to console me, like, "Hey, it's fine." But you know, just that moment, it stays in my psychology. So when I go into a group and I'm about to say something, like it's that fear of like this might come up again, like this might always come up. And
did you avoid it afterwards?
100%. I avoided any sort of situation where I had to present in front of class, in front of like my team, my peers, like sports events, things like that. I was just me doing myself, me always doing myself and doing it the best I can do. And, you know, and so this is something I'm still working on. I'm still really trying to break this fear that's deep rooted within me and face it. And that's something that's a very big challenge of mine.
I think you've done a pretty good job, actually.
Well, I like you using that example too, because a lot of times our fear is insidious, and it's something that is deeply rooted in like this insecurity that you've had since you were like a child, and you don't even realize it.
Yeah.
Like, and I'll give you an off analogy that has nothing really to do with like health and fitness, or even like COVID right now, but just how fear can creep in and be this kind of forever driver. And until you learn to become self-aware about it and then begin to unpack it, do you ever get move forward with it or overcome it at all? And, you know, for me, and I've shared on the podcast before that, you know, a lot of my motivation, right? Here's another thing too. A lot of times that we justify fear that we're motivated. Oh, this motivated me. Like when I was a young kid, you know, there was situations where, you know, we didn't pay our PG&E bill, so lights were out, couldn't have the refrigerator running, we were living out of a cooler, evicted from houses, stuff like that, right? And, you know, as a young kid, what I thought was, or what I didn't connect as this, you know, childhood fear that I had, it was, I don't want to be like mom and dad, and that's what motivates me to be successful, and that was like this main driver for me. But the truth is, I was fearful. My fear as I got older was, I don't want to be like that, or I never want to be in that situation. And so it would cause all these other behaviors that I would do. And sometimes that could be something like I lost relationships. I was so driven financially to be successful and was so fearful of not having or potentially being, you know, out, you know, on the streets, that I would just completely get tunnel vision, ignore my partner, because that's all that mattered to me was having it. Now, and the reality of it, I mean, I've never had to want or need since I've been a young adult. Since mm-hmm. since I started working at 19 years old, I've always had money. I've always had a savings. I've always been okay. But not in my head. In my head, because it's so deeply rooted in this fear of not having or being in that situation, my perspective, it still to this day, even when Katrina and I have conversations, the difference is that I'm aware of that fear now, and I'm aware of how insidious it is, that when it rears its head in today's time for me, and if I start to notice it cause an issue in my, like a relationship, like with Katrina and I, and this is a true story, literally fucking 3 days ago, you know, Katrina sends me over, you know, the bill that we have to pay the our housekeeper. And obviously, I'm in a place where I can afford to have a housekeeper and do these things. I have a savings or invested. We run our business very conservatively. And I, like, you know, come unglued on her because it's like $60 more than what it was like before or whatever, right? And I'm just like, you know, why I don't understand. Why didn't? And then I'm like, you know, blaming her for not telling me sooner. And she's like, you know that we have this. You're the one who wants it. Why are you giving me such a hard time? And And I'm all heated in the moment, and I'm pointing other things out that, well, you didn't tell me the week before, and why is it this? Because it was this before that. And I'm like, and then I have to catch my breath, realize that it doesn't fucking matter if it's north or south $60. At the end of the day, I do want the help and the service. We have the money and the savings. It's not a big fucking deal whatsoever. All that shit comes all the way back to my fear as a kid of not having and being broke, and therefore I overreact on all these other things. And so it's crazy when it's very easy when it's an obvious thing like COVID-19. You know, that's in front of all of us right now. And, you know, even the people that don't claim to be fearful, there's got to be some part of you, or you don't have a heart or compassion if you're not fearful for a loved one. You know, everybody's got an obese or a diabetic family member or somebody in advanced age who is a direct threat to, or in risk, the high risk category for this. And so you should have at least some sort of fear or compassion of them potentially getting it, even if you don't think you think you are invincible. So these are obvious fears in front of us. But there's a lot of these things that are deeply rooted and cause our behaviors and the way we react today. And learning to understand them and go through them is extremely important.
It's very important. And again, fear is it's essential. It's natural. A certain amount of it is healthy, just like you said, Adam. If you had literally no fear, it'd be a very dangerous world that we would live in. But it can definitely run amok. It can cause some problems. And I think now more than ever, at least in my lifetime, this is the risk that we have to kind of pay attention to because kind of what's going on. Now, fear does a few interesting things to your body. Of course, it's needed to help you prepare to react to danger. That's why we have it in the first place. The reason why you feel it in the first place is because it actually prepares you and your body to deal with danger. It actually sharpens certain functions that help you survive, like your eyesight. Your eyesight actually sharpens when you're scared. Your amygdala gets activated to focus on present danger and store it as a memory. Okay, so this is good. This is a good thing when it's beneficial to you. This is a bad thing when it's not. Because now, why is it a good thing to focus on present danger and store it as a memory? Well, if I walk around that tree over there and there's a group of guys that, you know, try to rob me.
Or ninja suits.
That'd be weird.
Yeah.
They try to rob me. I'm going to remember that corner. I'm going to remember that part of the neighborhood. I'm not going to go back there. You know, go back thousands of years, it was a lion. I went around, oh, there's a group of lions over there. I definitely remember the location. We're not going over there anymore. That's a very important thing. But check this out. Here's the opposite side of that. It actually, chronic fear, and here's where the problem is, okay, is chronic fear. This is when it becomes an issue. Chronic fear actually starts to damage parts of the brain like the hippocampus, and it impairs long-term memory. So you remember fearful shit more, and you forget everything else more.
Oh, man.
So over time, chronic fear actually starts to paint a scary world.
Dude, it's so important. I had to cut in and say something to you because this was something that I, not that long ago, had this epiphany of what you're explaining right now. and maybe this will speak to somebody else who has a similar experience. And this has helped me with my relationship with my parents. So I have a lot of animosity because of the shit that what happened as a kid. But part of what I've recognized as I've gotten older and become more aware, and to the point you're making right now, Sal, is that it's really shitty that this works this way. But I know, you know, even though my memories have faded a lot since I was a kid, I know every day it wasn't fucking turmoil and sad. My fucking life wasn't that bad. The shitty part is the way we're wired, I remember all of that clear as fucking day.
Right.
Mm-hmm. I don't remember the Disneyland trip. I don't remember the freaking time we were all laughing as a family together. I don't have those. Those are not solidified in my brain. All of the fucking bad shit is, and all the stuff I was fearful of or the moments I was scared in my life as a kid growing up. And there was a lot of those. But I know here's the thing. There was a lot of those, but there were still a lot more good times. Yeah. But the shitty part is understanding the way the brain works and knowing that my brain was not wired to hold on to all the good stuff. It was wired to remember the scary shit and solidify that. And so what takes a lot of self-awareness as we age and get older is to learn to detach and separate that and understand that fact that, oh, wow, maybe a lot of this negative view I have about someone or something or situations is my own perceived view of it because the way my brain operates, that it saves all that stuff like on the hard drive, bad, 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 but it really wasn't that bad. So that's something that you have to think about.
Yeah, you can see that too, how we prop up a lot of entertainment, a lot of news, a lot of all these things that are very much, you know, negative focus, like things that we're fearful of happening. And if it's happening on any part of the world, we want to know about it. You know, that's the most important thing, is to avoid, you know, whatever's happening way the hell somewhere else that I should not be concerning myself with right now. But that's been the pattern because it's so much easier now with global access to information across the world for us to consume whatever we can in terms of that type of information. And this, unfortunately, just keeps, you know, perpetuating this vision of the world being in turmoil and everything being like negative. And that's what you're focused on. You're fixated on it.
Totally. It literally, what ends up happening is it literally starts to, because your perception is your reality. Whatever you think reality is just how you perceive things. So some people can have a perception of reality that is more positive, that is filled with more gratitude, that is silver linings everywhere. My wife, Jessica, is excellent at this. You know, when she talks about growing up and in her life and all that stuff, I know she had a hard life. I know she wasn't but she's very good at the silver lining. So she does a good job of framing things. And so when she thinks of things and talks about them, you know, I shake my head, wow, a lot of what you say and think is positive, even though I know a lot of this other stuff happened. So if you don't do that and you allow chronic fear to take over, your perception starts to slowly change. And we know this even physically with your brain. Hippocampus starts to shrink. Amygdala is always activated. So now what ends up happening is you have a scary perception of the world that's also confirmed by your memories. So now it's like a self-feeding, feedback loop, and things feel worse and worse. This is why sometimes it can be so hard to get out of a fear loop. It can be so hard to stop it because it feeds itself continuously. Fear slows down and changes digestion. Now it does this because when there's a real present danger, you want your digestion to stop for a second. You want all the energy to go to your muscles and your eyesight and your hearing so you can escape. But over time, chronic fear damages your digestion, actually leads to IBS. It can make you more susceptible to things like ulcers. Chronic fear decreases fertility. Now, why would chronic fear decrease fertility? Well, you think your body thinks it's wise for you to produce a child in an environment that's scary? It doesn't have to be scary, by the way. Again, it's how you perceive it to be. So if you perceive it to be scary, your brain and your body, it is scary. That's just it. So now we're going to decrease fertility. Hormones start to change, right? Testosterone levels actually drop in men. Short-term fear can actually sometimes make it spike, but long-term chronic fear makes it go down. You're now becoming weaker. Your body's actually starting to become weaker. It accelerates aging. In extreme cases, fear can actually cause death and premature death. They know this for a fact. And we know that through studies of people who live a long time, that one of the reasons why they could live a long time is that they don't suffer from they perceive things to be okay. You don't have to be fake by it. You don't have to perceive things to be amazing, but they tend to perceive things as being okay and fine rather than being super, super scary all the time. So we know about all of this, right? So we know that chronic fear can cause problems, health problems. We know that chronic fear can drive irrational behaviors. We know that it can change our behaviors with our partners and families. It can change our, if we decide to open a business or take our, you know, change our jobs. I know people that are stuck in jobs that they hate, mm-hmm. but they're so scared of something different that they stay in something that they know that they hate. It can change your diet and what kind of foods you're driven to eat. Your body's looking for quick energy. Maybe you're looking for quick reprieve, so you're more likely to eat foods that are unhealthy. It drives things. It can drive things in a negative way. Knowing that and knowing the current situation, what do we do?
Well, there's things that you can do. For example, voluntary arousing negative experience. Right. These are examples of like roller coasters, scary movies, you know, going into a situation that you know is dangerous or scary, but it's your choice to head into that.
It builds confidence.
Yeah. You're exercising that muscle, that
it's
part
like
of
exposure therapy,
that part of the body, how you react to it, how you handle it, both mentally and physically. It's a way, and this is this really connects to our mindset episode. This really connects to the story of sharing Jessica's childhood and my childhood. You know, part of why I've had a lot of success as I've gotten older is because I thought I had incredible training ground when I was younger. Mm-hmm. So if I went through all this stress and scary and sad stuff when I was younger, you start to exercise that, and it becomes easier and easier every time you face that. So then when you do get hit with something that maybe everybody else thinks is, oh my God, so scary, it doesn't even really crack that for you. Mm-hmm. In fact, I said that on my questions the other day when, somebody was asking me about, you know, how am I handling anxiety during this time? And I said, honestly, when I use, and I put in quotations, this time, and I talk about it, a lot of it is coming from a place of empathy for I know a lot of people are. I know a lot of people are having a really, really, I've got family and people close to me that do have a lot of anxiety, that have lost jobs, that are extremely stressed out. But if I'm being completely honest, this doesn't even hit my top 100 of the most scariest, stressful times in my life. So I'm handling it like I would handle every single day. Now, a part of that is the preparation, both physically, financially, mindset-wise, that I have going into all this, I think that has a lot to do with it. But a lot has to do with the mindset, too, of being okay with exercising this, you know, going, finding your fears and facing it and going through it. Mm-hmm. The more you do that, the better you will get at that practice.
Well, you know why that sounds why there's something very positive about that? Because I know a lot of people, when things start to go back to normal, when it's time to go back to work, it's time to, you know, start, and, you know, with precaution, all that stuff, people are going to be very afraid of walking into the office with 30 other coworkers, and it's going to suck. It's going to really suck. But what's comforting about what you're saying, Adam, is when you do it, the more you do it, the less it'll suck. Mm-hmm. So be prepared for the fact that know that you're doing it voluntarily.
No.
Go into it and know that it's going to get better. But yeah, that is a training technique. It's to put yourself in scary situations that you can control.
Well,
you get better at it.
And why I do like talking about this is because it bleeds into business. It bleeds into fitness. You know how many clients I had that when we first started to, you know, start their training, and I'd ask them, you know, why today? Why, you know, you're 40 something years old and you're finally getting started. A lot of the fear was the fact that they would fail before. I didn't even want to start because I didn't know where to start, or that I would just gain it all back. I had tried a few times before, and then so they had already decided in their brain that, you know, they're going to fail, or they have fear of failing if they try it again. And the only reason why maybe they're there today is because their doctor said, if you don't do it, you're going to die. And it's like almost scared them into that position. And so, again, motivated by fear to come in to hire this personal trainer. But I know there's a lot of people out there that are like that, that are just afraid to, and that, again, could be your fitness goals. It could be a business or leaving a company, like you said, Sal, and going to do something else. At the end of the day, if you don't practice that, if you don't practice facing those fears and overcoming and becoming comfortable, we said this in the mindset episode, become comfortable with the worst outcome. Accept the worst thing that could happen, the absolute worst.
This is a tough exercise to do.
It is.
It's not easy.
And make peace with it and then move forward from it. Because any energy that you waste dwelling on the uncontrollable is wasted energy that you could be using to move forward.
Totally. Mm-hmm. I think you need to accept what you can't control. So you do what you can and then leave the rest to the fact that you can't control it. Because I think what ends up happening is we think that that if we worry about it, it'll be better somehow. Like if I keep worrying about this, I won't forget it.
You're going to solve something.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, I think a lot of people can identify with trying to be like a fixer. Like, I want to like keep like, like mulling this over in my mind. So that way there's something that makes sense to me that like I have a plan of action or something I can do. But these are things that are uncontrollable.
Mm-hmm.
And there's many forms of that in life. And the more that you can, you know, put your brain around the fact that there are going to be the unaccounted for, you know, types of forces out there that are going to come and you're going to experience it.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to make friends with the fact that they exist and that you can only control what you can control and just know what those things are and stay there.
Well, there's also ways for you to train this, right? So part of what makes this stress and the fear compound is that fight or flight part of your brain. When it goes there, it thinks you're in danger, and so it goes to the flight or flight. And then there's ways for you to learn to get out of that. So, you know, sexual activity, meditation, exercise, all these things are ways to move you out of that part of your brain. And so when you get into this situation, especially when it's uncontrollable, like we're dealing with right now, you know, instead of dwelling on it so much, take action by trying to do some of these things that will pull you out of that flight or fight. And the better you get at recognizing outside uncontrollable fear and taking action quicker, and you get quicker and quicker at that, the less fear you'll have.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, meditation's good because it helps stop the loop. Because
mm-hmm.
when you're in chronic fear mode, it can.
So does masturbation.
Actually, that's. That's actually, you know, it's funny.
It erupts your way out.
They yeah. say that sexual activity is a great way to get out of fear mode. The problem is getting aroused while scared for some people might not be possible.
It takes a little longer.
Yeah, I mean, I can't be alone as a guy.
Your wife's like, I'm so scared. Yeah. Take your pants off. What? Screw you.
I can't be alone as a guy whoever couldn't sleep and it was in his head. So when I think about like being in my head at night, I can't sleep. I know that some of that's rooted in anxiety. I'm thinking about, oh, where's the business going to be tomorrow? Oh, with this employee. And so there's fear and anxiety. I'm like, well, nothing gets rid of that better than masturbating or anything. You know what I'm saying? That just breaks that loop right away. You know,
the fear right out of yourself.
Fall right to sleep.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it is true. Connecting with people, physical activity. Physical activity is a great one too. Like hard physical activity mm-hmm. can make you feel present. Now, why is that beneficial? By the way, you don't want to abuse that one, but if you use it properly, okay, how does hard physical activity help with fear? Okay, besides the physical health that you can get from it, besides the fact that your muscles are going to be stronger and you're leaner and your brain's working better from a physical standpoint, all of that stuff helps, by the way.
Gets you out of your head, makes you present.
Expended energy.
It makes you, you're there. Like you're working hard.
Yeah.
You are thinking about what you're doing right now.
Yeah, yeah.
And what it does is it breaks the loop. So when you're frozen with fear, you're stuck in this fear loop, and sometimes all you need is enough reprieve to be able to look at it. But you can't look at it when you're in it. So hard activity, going on a hike, doing a hard workout, putting on some music, and getting a good lift in, you're out of it long enough to where you broke the loop. You're like, oh, man, I feel so much better. Now you can look at, man, I was in a fear loop there, like, and you can examine it. Meditation does the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
Meditating is literally practicing, you know, for lack of a better term, practicing just being present and it breaks that loop so you can move out of it.
It's crazy you say that because it's and this is my experience, so I could be totally off base with this, but in my experience, a lot of my friends that I know that are serious like power lifters actually are internally tortured by other stuff. And why I think they part of why I think they love powerlifting so much, because any power lifter will tell you this, throw 600 pounds on your back.
You ain't thinking about nothing but that.
You can't. It completely takes you out of everything else that's going on in the world, and it puts you 100% focused. And what it takes to become a 600-pound squatter or deadlifter is an immense amount of training under load for a very long period of time. So a lot of times those guys and girls that I've met, they have got a lot of other outside stress and bullshit, but that's their church, their safe space. That's their place where they have the most calm and focus is under the most physical demand and stress. It's pretty crazy.
I can identify with that on some level. I think too, like, you know, just getting out of your mind and focusing on the body and like being in the body, like it really helps to kind of close or shut down that perpetual loop quite a bit. And just expending energy, it helps to kind of divert a lot of that energy that's going into these thoughts, which is, you know, it's super beneficial for me. Like I need to expend energy constantly to be able to keep my mind sharp.
Yeah, and the key is to understand this is you're not going to like get rid of fear so that you're all of a sudden fearless. That would make you not human. Yeah. It's that the fear doesn't control you in unhealthy and irrational ways, and it's accepting that you have some fear. You know, when a firefighter runs into a burning building, do you think they don't have fear? Of course they do. It just doesn't control them. Mm-hmm. It doesn't stop them. They're disciplined enough to acknowledge the fear, but to move forward anyway so that it doesn't influence their behavior so that they make big mistakes. So one way you can reframe some of this is to think of yourself as a hero. Well, when things open back up and it's time to go back to work, you are doing the world, you're doing your country and the world a good thing by getting yourself out there, risking yourself so that things can move forward again. You take the precautions, you wash your hands, be careful who you're around, all that stuff, but you move forward anyway. And sometimes, you know, years ago, I was going to do a talk in front of a very, very large group, and talking in front of people, not really an issue for me normally. I'll get the normal amount of nervousness, but not a big deal. But this was a group of people that were above me in position. They were all people I looked up to. There was a lot of them. I was going to go out there. I was going to do my thing, and I started to get real nervous. And I remember I think that the manager I worked under recognized that I was a little nervous, and he told me, he says, "Sal, I need you to go out there, and I need you to get these people to feel passion and motivation like you feel." And all he did was make me feel like the hero. Still scared, but now I felt like I had to do this for other people. I was up there. Fear is still there, but now I'm moving forward. This is just one way you can reframe, just like the cave story. You know, I think about that because I think to myself, because believe me, listen, this is hitting me right in my fear spot. There's certain things for me that are very difficult to deal with. And I'm a bit of a germaphobe anyway. So this is like a worst case scenario for someone like me. And I think about this cave scenario because when I think about doing things for my family, no amount of fear will stop me. Still feel it. It's not going to stop me. In fact, it feels empowering. Mm-hmm. And that's back to the control thing that I think you were talking about. So reframing the situation. But when things change, when it's time for us to step out into the world again, take your precautions, but also be rational. Don't let the fear control you. And what you may need to do is you may need to incorporate more practices to help solve this for you. You may need to develop a meditation or prayer practice. Maybe you don't have one now, but now you might need one. You might need to practice things like gratitude. Gratitude is a great way to offset fear. Mm-hmm. When you're scared, to consciously think about things that you're grateful for. Exercise is more important now than it was when you wanted to lose 15 pounds. I'm just going to tell you that right now. It's nice that you wanted to burn body fat and you want to build muscle and you want to look great. That's all great. But if you're feeling controlled by your fear or you're afraid of getting back into the world, exercise is a much more important role for you. It's not fat burning. It's not building muscle. It's helping you deal with your fear, helping you control it rather than it control you. And with that, go to mindpumpfree.com and download all of our guides and resources. You can also find the three of us on Instagram. You can find Justin at Mind Pump Justin. You can find me at Mind Pump Sal, and Adam at Mind Pump Adam.